So what I want to do is just pick up on where we were, what we were talking about in our interview with C.S. Lewis. And this is a quote from C.S. Lewis that, that I encountered when I was about 20 years old. And it is one of those things. People said to me, you ought to read C.S. Lewis. You're going to grow in your faith. And I did that, and this is the final sentence of one of Lewis's lectures at Oxford. It's called, Is Theology Poetry? Question mark. If you want to know the answer, well, it all depends on what you mean by poetry and what you mean by theology, but this is how that lecture ended. And I read these works, and I thought, these words are just wonderful. This is articulating an idea that Christianity illuminates reality. It's a very powerful imaginative way of thinking. And Lewis is very, very good at stimulating our imaginations. And he's saying, look, imagine you are standing on a hill at dawn, and below you everything is dark, it's shrouded in mist, and as the sun rises, the shadows begin to disappear, the mist begins to burn off, and you see things clearly. A little bit of shadows remain, a little bit of mist, but you see much more clearly than before. Christianity illuminates life and lets you see the way things really are, and you reorientate yourself accordingly. I find that wonderful. It was so deep, so rich. I thought, this needs further investigation, and so I began to look at that. So let me show you a picture of C.S. Lewis. This is a picture of C.S. Lewis in May 1917 at Oxford University. And he is standing there, the back, far right-hand side. He's looking at us. And I want to do a mental experiment with you. Do you think Lewis was thinking, in about 50 or 60 years' time, I'm going to be one of the best-known Christian writers there is and help lots of people grow in their faith? Well, no, he would not, because this is May 1917 in the First World War. And Lewis at this time was quite an aggressive atheist. And he was at Oxford not to study academically, because the First World War had interrupted that. He'd gone to Oxford and was going to go into a military training unit. And then in November of that year, he would be posted to the front line of the First World War in northwestern France. And the question on Lewis's mind would have been, will I come home? Because the attrition rate, the death rate amongst junior officers was very, very high. There's a very famous letter of Lewis to one of his friends saying there were five of us who trained at Oxford. I'm the only one who came back. So 80% attrition rate. So Lewis, in effect, there, no sense of what lay ahead in the future. And historically, that's very interesting. Theologically, this is about God's grace in action. Because in effect, in God's great wisdom, God took somebody who was an atheist and knew why he was an atheist and made him into a Christian who knew why he was a Christian. So he was able to speak to atheists, to non-believers, and say, I know where you are. I've been there, but I've moved on, and I want you to move on too. So Lewis, in many ways, is an ideal apologist. He's just so well placed to talk about things. So there's a very brief background to Lewis. You can read that. But the point I really want to note is the triple first at Oxford. What does that mean? It means that Lewis began by studying classics. There are 2 points at which you're assessed in that Oxford degree. Lewis got first class honours. That's the highest honours you can get in both of those. And then did the Oxford English degree in 1 year. The Oxford English degree is meant to last 3 years. Lewis packed it all into 1 year and got first class honours. So you can see immediately we are dealing with a very intelligent person. But interestingly, Lewis, as he was thinking about the great questions of life, I think he began to think, well, look, atheism might be interesting, but it doesn't really engage my imagination. It doesn't really answer my big questions. And so we find Lewis beginning to think atheism was rather impoverished and impoverishing. In other words, it limits you. I'll come back to that later in this lecture. And we find Lewis writing these words in his autobiography, Surprised by Joy. A young man who wished to remain a sound atheist cannot be too careful of his reading. There are traps everywhere. What Lewis meant by that is you will read writers who say things that suddenly make you think, oh, I need to rethink things. One of those writers was George Herbert, a well-known English poet. And Lewis said, look, at this time Lewis was an atheist. This guy is kind of a build, he's investing in this Christian mythology stuff. But he understands what human nature is all about, and he's found the ways of expressing this, beginning to realize that there are other options available. So Lewis, I think, is very interesting in many ways. Basically, Lewis really came to faith in two stages. The first stage was a realization, which probably happened in the summer of 1929, although that is open to discussion. But he really came to realize that belief in God made far more sense than atheism. And it really gave him a sense of identity and purpose, but he could not see how to move from believing that there was a God to believing in Christianity. And to understand how that transition happens, we need to introduce you to J.R.R. Tolkien. When I say introduce, you probably all know that name very well, and you've read the books, you've probably seen the movies. I actually think that the movies are very good, but my friends who are strict J.R.R. Tolkien advocates say they are not good. They kind of do not do justice to him. But anyway, Tolkien and Lewis formed a friendship. They formed a friendship in 1925, and that kept going until Lewis's death. And they would talk about works of the imagination, works of fantasy. And in some of Lewis's letters, he writes to his friends about these conversations with Tolkien, and he talks about this work that Tolkien's thinking about, a work of fantasy, which of course eventually became something like The Lord of the Rings. And Tolkien later said for a long time he had an audience of one for this book. But Lewis was the guy who encouraged him to keep going and writing this. But Tolkien repaid Lewis in a very significant way. In September 1931, Lewis, J.R.R. Tolkien, Hugo Dyson, who became Professor of English at Oxford, had a long walk around Magdalen College Gardens. And they went round and round and round, and they were talking about the place of story in understanding the world and in faith. And Tolkien kept saying, Christianity tells a story. It captures the imagination. It's a narrated worldview. It, in effect, is setting out a way of imagining our world, which you can use to generate an intellectual system, but it's primarily a way of seeing things and involves telling stories to capture what God has done in history and its significance. And that made the connection for Lewis. He could see Christ is part of this. He, in effect, is part of this story. We're invited to join this story, and we'll look at this in more detail later. But clearly, what Lewis began to realize is that Christianity was about telling a story that was true, that interpreted the meaning of life, and gave you a way of beginning to do apologetics. And so you might think of his autobiography, Surprised by Joy, which in one sense is just Lewis telling his own story, but in another sense is setting out how he changed his mind and therefore how his readers could change their minds as well. So Lewis there, basically, I'll take you through his change of mind. Christianity is primarily a grand narrative, a narrated worldview, or a myth in the proper sense of the word, a story that is loaded with ideas. And by embracing the story, you embrace the ideas as well. So let's move on and look again at Lewis, because this is really quite interesting. This is a debate Lewis had in the late 1920s. The debate is historically interesting, but I'm going to focus on its apologetic importance. Lewis is asking this question, what does a writer do? What does a poet do? And his answer is very, very simple. The poet is not someone who asks me to look at him. He's someone who says, look at that, and points. In other words, it's all about having seen something. having realized something and wanting the audience to see this, to realize this as well. I've seen something, and in my writing, in my speaking, I want you to see this as well. The poet's not someone who asks me to look at him. He points and says, look at that. Not a spectacle, look at me, but a set of spectacles, look through me. And so what Lewis is doing in his writing is saying, I have seen something, and I want you to see this as well. What's he seen? Well, the vision of the gospel, an understanding of the Christian faith that makes sense, that transforms life. And what Lewis is saying, I've seen that. And in my writing, in my speaking, I want you to see that as well. So it's a very powerful approach to apologetics. It's about almost inviting you to see apologetics as stepping into a way of seeing the world and exploring it, asking what difference does this make? And that's in many ways what Lewis is doing in Narnia. Narnia, if you like, is about seeing the world in a Christian way. Lewis is inviting us to step inside us and see the difference that this makes. And I'll talk more about that later in this lecture. So Lewis was very, very clear that apologetics is important. And Lewis began to discover how stories could be really effective. So he looked at his very first work of apologetics, which is A Problem of Pain. Some of you have read that book. It's a cognitive analysis. The key thing you need to understand is that in many ways, this was Lewis's first attempt to do apologetics. And interestingly, he wrote this book not because he really wanted to, but because someone asked him to. Lewis was asked to write this book by an editor who had come across him and said, look, we need somebody to write a good book on this topic, the problem of pain. We think you could do this. Will you do it? In other words, it was external validation of Lewis's growing internal sense that he might be able to be an apologist. So you've read that book, probably, many of you, and it's still in print. It's a very good book in many ways. But it doesn't use narratives, really. And Lewis began to use that around this time and became increasingly aware of its importance in the 1940s. Why did Lewis use narratives to do apologetics? Well, the answer lies partly in a British writer called H.G. Wells. H.G. Wells, who wrote science fiction novels in the 1890s, such as The War of the Worlds, The Invisible Man, and books like that, The Time Machine. And Lewis had read these and thought something like this. This man writes very, very well, and his narrative captures my attention. But the narrative conveys a sort of materialist worldview. I don't like that. And Lewis at some point seems to have thought, what if I could use H.G. Wells's medium, in other words, writing narratives, but this time to critique the kind of worldview that H.G. Wells expresses. And so the first example of this we find is what's sometimes called the science fiction trilogy, The Other Silent Planet, Perelandra, That Hideous Strength. And some of you may have read those books, and you can see what Lewis is trying to do. He's telling a story which makes some important critiques of the way in which science can be abused, the problems with human nature, a whole series of things like that. And he's using a narrative that captures your attention to, in effect, open up an understanding of what human beings are, where they can go wrong, and what needs to be done to correct them. So actually, Lewis is beginning to explore this. Now, I've read these books, and I quite like them, but I like The Chronicles of Narnia much more, because by this stage, Lewis has really perfected this genre. Let's go back to That Hideous Strength, published in August 1945. One of the key themes in this book is that science enables humanity to do some things, and the problem is we aren't ready for what science can do. There's a sense in which, you know, once we make certain moves, we can't undo them. And of course, Lewis's book was published on August the 11th, 1945, just after the atomic bombs were dropped on Japan. And certainly in Britain, people began to feel this man, Lewis, has pointed out a real problem. Science has caused us to enter a new world, and it's a frightening world, and we're not ready to live in that. So in many ways, Lewis was using narratives to open up these deep questions. But of course, the Chronicles of Narnia are the classic example of that, and I'll talk about those in a few minutes. Then Lewis moved to Cambridge in 1955. It was a good move. Lewis had been at Oxford for too long. He'd made lots of friends. He'd made lots of enemies. But at Cambridge, he went to a very small college, very friendly college, felt completely at home there. And he began to do a slightly different kind of apologetics. Lewis talks about this. He says, look, I've been talking to people outside the church, outside faith for too long. I now need to help those who want reassurance about their faith. In other words, if you like, he used to face this way, addressing a wide culture. Now he turns and faces a church audience and saying, I want to help Christians grow in their faith. So books like Reflections on the Psalms, The Four Loves are actually really written to help Christians grow in their faith. So that is something about Lewis. Let's now move on and look at some important point. I want to begin by thinking through with you the difference between stories and arguments, because they're quite different. I mean, I want to begin by saying that arguments are really important, because it is really important that we keep showing the rationality, the reasonableness of Christianity to our culture. That is something I think is very important. And Lewis does engage in some arguments, particularly in Mere Christianity, as I'm sure many of you will know. But stories, I think, allow us to say something slightly different. Not simply that Christianity is right, but also that Christianity is real. That Christianity has the capacity to capture us, to take us over, to in effect to change the way we live, not simply the way we think. And that's a very important point. Lewis is really emphasizing that the stories of our lives are apologetically important. It's not just showing Christian ideas are right. It's showing that Christian ideas make a difference. And therefore, in telling your stories, you're not simply saying, I think Christianity is right. You're also saying it is meaningful. It's life-changing. And that is really important, because there are many things that are true that are existentially irrelevant. Bear that in mind. I gave an example yesterday. I said, look, in Britain, Queen Victoria died in 1901. I'm going to tell you that it makes no difference to anyone whatsoever. But what Christianity is doing is telling a story which, if it's right, it changes everything. It's a game changer. And that's one of the points Lewis really brings out very clearly. And we need to show Christianity is relevant in the sense it can change our lives. And that means that telling our stories is really a very important aspect of our apologetic way of engaging people. Sure, we can argue, but one of the things we can also do is tell our own stories, because in doing so, we are saying not simply we believe Christianity to be right, but also exhibiting, demonstrating, manifesting the fact that Christianity has become part of us and we believe for the good. So that's what the background to all of this is. And I think it's very important that we think about our shifting culture. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the new atheism. That began to emerge in around 2006 with Richard Dawkins' book, The God Delusion. There was initially huge media interest, and it now has faded. I had to explain to someone in Oxford the other day who Richard Dawkins was, because they hadn't heard of him. But that just shows you how, in many ways, you know, something that seems terribly new and exciting fades away very quickly, and the new atheism has. And many new atheists are now expressing disillusionment and dissatisfaction. And you could explain this in various ways. You could give the arguments against the new atheism. But actually, a friend of mine, Dennis Alexander, and I, noticed that a lot of people would come to us and tell the stories of how initially they were drawn to Richard Dawkins. Then, as they looked into his writings more closely, they felt, this isn't right. This doesn't make sense. This is wrong. He overstates. He misrepresents Christianity. And so what we did was simply to bring together 12 stories, people telling their stories. We used to think Richard Dawkins was wonderful. We read him, and for various reasons, these journalists, these scientists, these politicians, and all these people, in effect, were saying we were disillusioned and began to look at Christianity more closely and are now Christians. And the point is, while the arguments they use are interesting, it's their stories that really matter. And this book has sold really very well because it tells stories. It's 12 people telling their stories. So that's interesting. But let's go back now to Lewis. Austin Farrer was a friend of C.S. Lewis at Oxford. He was a New Testament scholar, a philosopher, and he did reflect on why Lewis was such an effective apologist. And his point was that, you know, rational arguments are really important. Look at what he says. What seems to be proved may not be embraced, but what no one shows the ability to defend is quickly abandoned. Rational argument doesn't create belief, but maintains a climate which belief may flourish. That's a good point. He's saying this is showing there's a good reason for saying Christianity is right. May not convince everyone, but you know arguments exist for the rationality of faith. But Farrer says more is needed. So what does he have in mind? Well, basically, we need to appeal to the imagination. And that is what Farrer thinks Lewis does really well. Farrer himself writes, we can't apprehend anything without an act of imaginative creation. In other words, you need to capture somebody's imagination. You need to give them a picture, a story, which really they say, this is exceedingly interesting. Let's step into this, see what it's like. Let's explore this. And for Farrer, Lewis makes us think we're listening to an argument, but in reality, we're presented with a vision, and it's this vision that carries conviction. Lewis is setting out a way of seeing reality, a way of seeing ourselves, and this is really transformative. So that's the key point I want to make about Lewis here. He's aware stories capture us, our imagination, and they make us receptive to the ideas they convey. And if someone really is saying, this is exciting, I want to know more, think, for example, of Dionysius listening to the Apostle Paul in Athens. We will hear more of this. You know, that's very important, I think. But basically, it's all about capturing the imagination. And Lewis is very much aware of this. Lewis had a very interesting response to people who said telling stories is a form of escapism. This is very interesting. He wrote these words. My friend Professor Tolkien asked me the very simple question, what class of people would you expect to be most preoccupied with and hostile to the idea of escaping? He gave the obvious answer, jailers. In other words, people who want you to stay captivated to, for example, a naturalist or a materialist worldview are not going to be happy with the kind of stories that either Tolkien or Lewis are telling, because they say this is only one way of thinking about things. There are others, and these others are better. And that's the key point that Lewis makes here. But moving on, let's look at a quote from Ludwig Wittgenstein, which some of you will know, but if you don't, this is really helpful apologetically. In German, as you can see, ein Bild hielt uns gefangen, but in English, a picture held us captive. I want you just to hold that idea in your mind. A picture held us captive. The point that Wittgenstein's making is that very often people find themselves locked into a way of imagining, a way of thinking, and as a result, they refuse to recognize there's anything beyond this very limited world. And also, they will reject alternatives because it does not fit in with this picture. And Wittgenstein, as you probably know, adopts what is called a therapeutic approach to philosophy. Philosophy is there to break you free from the thrall, from the enslavement to inadequate ways of thinking. And Wittgenstein is making the point that we need to be aware that while one image, one picture may hold us captive, other images are available, other pictures. And so apologetically, they're saying, look, maybe you think the world is all there is. Maybe you're locked into some form of naturalism. But let's think about alternatives. Let's look at some other pictures. Imagine you're going to a picture gallery, okay? And you're looking at this one, then you look at that one, and this one, and this one. And you're not limited by one. There are others available. And Wittgenstein's point is that our culture very often locks itself into one way of thinking. And the task of apologetics is to say there are other ways of thinking possible and to live by this. And in many ways, that's what Lewis is doing, though he doesn't quote Wittgenstein. He really is saying, look, I'm going to show you other ways of imaging, picturing the world and living within it. And so it's a very powerful idea. It's about critiquing the dominant worldview and saying alternatives are available and explaining what feels like to stand within a Christian way of thinking. And Lewis's Chronicles of Narnia, in many ways, are in effect setting out this way of thinking. So let's begin to think about Narnia, because that, I think, is the main topic of this lecture. And Lewis here draws on his experiences of his childhood. And Lewis was reflecting on this question: why is it that so many young children are put off Christianity? And his answer, whether right or wrong, is that very often Christianity is presented to them in very didactic and unimaginative ways. And Lewis remembers the sheer joy he experienced in reading stories like, well, I don't know if any of you have read Squirrel Nutkin or those kind of stories. They were very popular in Edwardian England when Lewis was growing up. But basically, Lewis was thinking, why can't somebody write a story which expresses Christianity in an imaginatively powerful and engaging way, which leads you into a world which might not be called Christianity, but which nevertheless exhibits what Christianity is all about? And of course, that's what Narnia really is. So if you like, Lewis here really is reaching back into his own past and is using children's stories as a gateway to the imagination, not just for young people, but also for grown-ups. And one of the points that Lewis makes in an essay he wrote on fairy stories is that while children, you know, naturally seem to resonate with these kind of stories, actually, they also work very well for adults as well. Lewis's idea of a supposal is very important here. This is what Lewis means by that idea. Suppose, imagine, you know, suppose there were a world like Narnia, and it needed rescuing, and the Son of God, or the great emperor overseas, went to redeem it, as he came to redeem ours. What might it in that world all have been like? Now, that's what Lewis is doing, is retelling, reimagining the Christian narrative of creation, redemption, and final consummation. And he's telling it as a children's story. And what he is doing, in effect, is exploring what the Christian way of thinking looks like and allowing people to discover this and beginning to feel, I could belong here. And as you will know, one of the final points Lewis makes in The Last Battle is that this is where we really belong. It's just the beginning of a story that gets more wonderful with each chapter you open. And he's trying to help us to understand what Christianity is all about. So in many ways, Narnia is retelling the story of faith. But Lewis, I think, makes a very important point right at the beginning of this series. I personally think The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe is the first in the series. You ought to read it before you read anything else, because I know The Magician's Nephew chronologically comes before this, but really, it's a prequel. You read it after you've read The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. And as the children begin to go into this world of Narnia, as they go through the wardrobe, they enter the strange world and they hear different stories about what this world is, where it came from, and who really owns it. And that, I think, is a very important point. They have to ask which story, and also, of course, which storyteller is to be trusted. And the point that Lewis is making is we hear different stories about our own world. This is a world in which we simply arrived here by random. It means nothing. Or it is the world created by a loving God for whom each of us are very special and loved. And the question, the point Lewis is making is we have to decide which story do we trust and which story do we inhabit? Which story do we step into and say, this is not simply a story, this is my story, all part of who I am. So Lewis is being really very helpful here in giving us some ways of thinking. So we find the children wondering, is Narnia really the realm of the White Witch, or is she a usurper whose power will be broken when the sons of Adam and daughters of Eve sit on the thrones at Caer Paravel? Is Narnia really the realm of mysterious lion Aslan? Not here at the moment, but when he comes back, everything's going to be different. And what children have to do is realize not simply there are different stories, but which one do I trust? So it's a very powerful narrative because gradually, as you will know, one narrative emerges as supremely trustworthy. And the children, in effect, say, this is a story we trust. And that, I think, is a very important point. You might also note that in Narnia, this story tends to be told by the little people, by Mr. Beaver, not by the big people who have vested interests and want you to stay locked into the dominant narrative of the age. And what Lewis is saying is, look, it may be that there's a narrative that has achieved cultural dominance. That doesn't mean it's right. We need to help people see that there are other stories we can tell, and these are far more satisfying. So basically, Lewis makes the point that the Christian story is a series of interlocking stories that make sense of the riddles of what the children see and experience around them. And that is a really important theme for Lewis. And I haven't got time to talk about this in detail in this lecture, but certainly let me reassure you, one of the key themes of Lewis's approach to apologetics is that the Christian way of thinking, the Christian story, the Christian meta-narrative, the grand picture, whatever you want to call it, is not simply good at explaining what we see around us and experience within us. It also generates meaning and values. In other words, it helps us understand who we really are. It reassures us that we really do matter, and it makes sense of this world, but it also gives us a deeper understanding of who we really are. Back to that image I gave you right at the beginning of this lecture, the sun rising. And as it illuminates the world, we begin to realize that Christianity is able to make so much sense of what we see around us and experience within us. And we can talk more about that in Q&A if you'd like. But there is another point that Lewis wants to make, and maybe if you're going to remember only one thing from this lecture, it's this, okay? The really important point that Lewis wants to make is when the children realize this story is the best story, this is the right story, they become part of it. And the point Lewis is making is that the children each has their own story. Their individuality never disappears. They're always who they are. And yet they step into this bigger story. And so their own personal story is expanded, it's enriched, and they are given meaning and significance because they become part of a bigger story within which they each have a distinctive role to play. And that's a really important view. Let me just explain to you something about myself. When I was younger, when I was about 18 years old, I really became very interested in Marxism. This is back in the late 1960s. It was a very, very common theme around that time. And I didn't stay a Marxist for very long because I began to realize it didn't really make all that much sense. But I want you to understand this point. One of the reasons I was drawn to Marxism is it offered a big picture of our world. It explained social history, and it also said individuals can be part of this bigger story because they can advance this political agenda. And the thing that drew me to it was a story that made space for me. I could step into the story and become part of it. And so although I left Marxism behind, I never really left behind the idea, wouldn't it be wonderful if there was a different big picture, which actually was much more satisfactory, which made sense of experience and what we observe in the world, but also made space for us. And that's what Lewis is getting at here. He's getting at this idea that Christianity is not simply like a scientific theory, which says this offers you an explanation of what you're seeing. It is an invitation to participate, an invitation to step into the story and become part of it and explain the transformation that results. So that seems to me is a really very interesting and very important point. Now, this is a really important point because, as you will know, just putting some examples on the screen, there are lots of narratives that are being told. You might think of Dan Brown's Da Vinci Code. There's a huge literature now, by the way, on what is called conspiracy theories and the Da Vinci Code. It is a genre of study in its own right. But let's just look at these. Dan Brown's Da Vinci Code, the Harry Potter series of novels, or Philip Pullman's Dark Materials trilogy. How many of you have read the Da Vinci Code? I have, okay. Oh, quite a lot, good, okay. Here is my experience of reading the Da Vinci Code. I picked it up and I thought, oh, right, okay, this is clearly quite hostile to Christianity. Began to read it. Oh, he got the Council of Nicaea wrong. Oh, dear. I wonder what happens next. And what happened was I kept going, even though I thought this doesn't make sense, it's wrong. But the narrative was so well written, it drew me in and kept me going. And that's a very important point. Narratives draw people in. And so I think really one of the points I want to make, and maybe there's somebody in this audience who might be able to do this, we need more narratives that tell the story of Christianity. Lewis is great, but we do need people to keep refreshing this. And if somebody here who can do that, please see this as an invitation to do something like this. The key point, I think, is to think about how we are able to tell the Christian story and show the difference that it makes. And that seems to me to be a very important point. So moving on from here, Lewis has many themes in his apologetic writings. One of them is we need to show Christianity tells a better story. Now, this is a short extract from a sermon Lewis preached in 1941 called The Weight, W-E-I-G-H-T, The Weight of Glory. It is a remarkable piece. In my view, it's probably one of the best things he wrote. It's only 5,500 words long. But in this sermon, Lewis talks about this Christian way of understanding reality, which in effect makes sense of things and invites us to become part of that, and invites us to compare the Christian story with its secular alternatives. And what Lewis is saying is we are held captive by a story. You and I have, in effect, been entrapped within a spell. The spell he's talking about is a form of materialism. And Lewis is saying simply that so many people have been entrapped within this spell. We need to break the spell, and we do it by casting a better spell, which is telling the Christian story. And that, I think, is really helpful. Lewis is really saying we need to show that Christianity out-narrates the dominant stories of our age. It tells a better story. Do you know, I talked about Wittgenstein being trapped by a picture. His solution is to look at other pictures and realize that these are liberating. Because what Lewis is talking about here is how we might judge worldviews. Now, many of us would say, well, one reason we might use to judge them is how well they are based on evidence, how internally consistent they are, and so on. But Lewis is adding another one. What are the impact of these on us? And what Lewis is saying is that materialism traps us. It limits us. In effect, it says this is all there is to reality. There is nothing beyond the material world. It shuts down these vitally important conversations. And Lewis's point to his audience back in 1941, which I will reiterate this morning, is that we need a counter-narrative which says, you tell us there is nothing beyond the material world. That is not something you can prove. That is your opinion. There are alternatives, and I represent one of those alternative perspectives, which is that we come to life by discovering that there is more to this world than simply materialism. We tell a story which subverts this dominant materialist narrative. And Lewis is inviting us really to do that. So obviously there's much more I could say about that, but the key point I simply want to make is Lewis is saying that narratives are really important. This is a quote from J.R.R. Tolkien. I'll explain what it means. If God is mythopoeic, then man must become mythopathic. The point that Tolkien is making, and Lewis picked this up, is if God likes telling stories, then we need to like listening to stories. And it's really just saying that we are not kind of way inventing stories as an apologetic technique. Tolkien is saying this is a legitimate way of doing this. And if you want to go further, Tolkien actually grounds this in the doctrine of the image of God. That in effect for Lewis, for Tolkien, the image of God is a kind of imaginative template, which means we tend to tell stories which reflect our real identity as God's creatures. So my question really in bringing this lecture to a close is this: what stories can we tell? I've emphasized that for Lewis, we need to break the stranglehold of dominant materialist narratives. How can we do that? And Lewis's answer is, in part, by telling better stories. So what stories might we tell? Well, a very good place to begin might be the Bible, which contains many, many stories. And perhaps we can use those to begin to capture people's imaginations and plant seeds of doubt about the dominant narratives of our culture. For example, think about the parables. The parable I often use in talking to people about this is the parable of the pearl of great price from Matthew chapter 13. You all know that story. It's about a merchant who presumably knows good things when he sees them, but sees this beautiful pearl and knows he will not be satisfied until he buys it and is prepared to sell everything in order to buy it. Without that pearl, his life is incomplete. Now, you can tell that story. You can say, in fact, look, I was journeying through life. I tried various ways of thinking, little pearls. Then, finally, I discovered this beautiful pearl, which I didn't have to buy. It was given to me, and it's changed my life. And that is a very important way of talking about this. You have found something transformative. And that's one of the things you need to explain to people. This story, this way of thinking, this image, this way of picturing reality, which we call Christianity, is able to capture imaginations, bring satisfaction, and liberate us from the shackles of materialist worldview. Or perhaps you could tell our own stories, which is what I'm leaning into in many ways. I could tell my story I told you a little bit about already, but you can see it's a story of somebody who once thought the only serious option was atheism, and then had to realize, A, atheism didn't really make all that much sense and wasn't existentially interesting, but Christianity was. And I learned that partly through talking to other Christians who told me their stories and helped me to see there was an alternative to what I had thought was the only serious option for a thinking person. So again, I want to emphasize that point. Each of you, by telling your own story, subverts the idea that there's only one story that can be told, which is a meaningless world, and that's it. Or, of course, we can pick up on something from Narnia. Lewis uses Narnia very profoundly. I'm going to end now by telling you one aspect of Narnia that really intrigues me. I find it difficult to explain the idea of sin to a postmodern audience. But very often when I'm doing that, I will pick up on the voyage of the Dawn Treader and the very famous episode, which is usually called the undragoning of Eustace. I'll tell you what that is, because it's very interesting, because it's one of the points in the Chronicles of Narnia in which Lewis is drawing on a Nordic heritage. So this is a tribute to this audience this morning. Eustace Scrub is a British schoolboy who is very, very greedy. And Lewis, in effect, develops this narrative that when you behave in a very, very greedy way, you become greedy. And of course, Lewis is very well steeped in Nordic mythology. He knows the myth of the dragon Fafnir. And so he, in effect, portrays Eustace as changing into a dragon. He's trapped. He's using this image to express the idea you are trapped and you can't break free. So Eustace, having enjoyed being a dragon for a short time, begins to realize it's not really all that much fun and says, I'd like to go back to being Eustace again, and tries to, you know, scratch off the dragon scales and says, I want to be back the way I was. And he realizes he is trapped, that there is a power that is holding him that he cannot conquer. He is not able to break free from his self-imposed imprisonment. In other words, sin is something that traps us. It's a very important element of the Christian understanding of sin, not the full picture I know, but a very important aspect of it. And then Lewis depicts Aslan arriving and taking Eustace, scratches off a dragon skin, puts him in a deep well, washes him, and he is restored. The point that Lewis is trying to make is sin is something that entraps us. It entraps us at the moral level. It entraps us at the imaginative level. It entraps us at the narrative level, because we think there's only one story, which is a materialist naturalism. And our role as apologists, like Lewis before us, is to say, that's just one way of thinking about it. There are other ways. And we need to break this power of a single narrative over people. Very often people talk about modernity as being dominated by a single narrative. What we need to say is there is a different way of thinking, a better way of thinking. Lewis, I think, helps us to do this. But in many ways, Lewis is really saying to all of us, he's handing over to us. He's asking us, what stories would we tell to try and break the power of the dominant narrative of our culture? I could say more. I would talk about the American philosopher or the Canadian philosopher, Charles Taylor, I think, is very good on this. But really, I just want to say C.S. Lewis is a wonderful stimulus as we think about how we explain Christianity and help people to see there is a better story that we can tell. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much indeed for listening.